Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. We have an update with Sable Resources. With me, I have Ruben Padilla, CEO, and my colleague Magda Gardner. It's been a while since we've had an update from Sable, so looking forward to hearing what's been going on. As always, this presentation will contain forward-looking statements. If you'd like to know more about those, you can find them on the company's website on the presentation. And there will be a Q&A section, so feel free to enter your questions in the box at the bottom of your screen, or you can email them to me or Magda. With that out of the way, I'd like to introduce Ruben. Hi, Ruben. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too, Deborah. And thank you for all the introduction again, and nice to be back.
Yeah, also, nice to have you back. Looking forward to hearing what you've been up to.
Yeah, you know, it's a good opportunity to come back and tell people all the work that we have been doing, and give a follow-up on the press release on Don Julio and the Cerro Negro. So this is a good opportunity for to put a good update. You know, I can start right now with the presentation.
So I think you're going to start with a bit of a presentation, then we'll handle some Q&A.
Exactly.
Awesome.
So here's the province of San Juan, where we are very active, where everybody knows, they follow us. It's just a map to show how active has been Argentina lately. You can see a lot of activities going on, especially in San Juan. You can see the area here of where Lundin and BHP now involved with in Filo del Sol and across the border in Chile. In the south, we have Pachón with Glencore. We have Altar, where a company is exploring a good deposit there. Also, South 32 has now a good percentage of that. McEwen with Los Azules is advancing very well, and with also good partnership with two different companies, including Rio Tinto. There's another good JV that was done by Teck here. And of course, the Valley of Chita, that is where we are located with the Don Julio Project. And South 32 has the earning agreement with us, and also with MinSouth that is our neighbor. So this area here, you can see the gap between this area in the north and the south, and we're working in this gap. So very active. San Juan is still the best jurisdiction for the Fraser Institute for investing in mineral exploration in Latin America. This is the chart, no more changes in the shares and options. The company is 286 million shares, and fully diluted is 209 million shares. We're still having the bank in this moment, $11.4 million in cash, which is very unusual for a junior company. And everybody remember, we own some NSRs in BC that we still have, and we haven't sold yet, but sooner or later, we're going to sell it to keep going with our exploration program. And we still have very good base of institutional shareholders. The map of San Juan, again, with our properties, you can see El Fierro, that everybody knows about that one. We drilled the property 2 years ago, in last year. And we have Don Julio. That is the one that I'm going to put more emphasis today. And we have two new properties, Cerro Negro and Potrerillos, in this area that I'm going to briefly mention today. As you can see in the map, we don't have Poncha anymore in this map because we decided that we did enough work. And this is the exploration. We did enough work. We don't believe that there's more chances of discovery. So we dropped the property. That's the nature of exploration. It's better to move away and keep going with the properties with good potential. Now, going to Don Julio, that I say is the main emphasis in this webinar. We finished the 23-24 field season, as I reported in the press release. Very interesting results. Now that we finished this work, many years of work, what we can say now that we have multiple mineral centers in an area of 7 by 6 kilometers in this area. We have at least 4 porphyry systems, Gringa here in this area. We have a Morro Poposa here, Punta Cana and Tocota, and probably also Colorado, a new target that we have. So very prolific area in terms of multiple mineral centers. And also very interesting, these are around 7 to 8 million years old porphyries. And we have 2 porphyry systems in the area, that is Porfirio Muerto and Gringa Paleozoic, that are 280 million years old, also were in place in the same area, plus another polymetallic skarn that is also Paleozoic. So a lot of things going on in this relatively small area. So going now to more specifics, We did a with a we completed a very good structural geology review. Now I just want to mention the main structure here. We have early paleozoic lay structure that are these red structure that you see here are mostly trust faults, reverse faults, including the Gringa fault here. There is a reverse fault that is high angle. These faults are very important, but control most of the little cap in Don Julio, and also we think control the porphyries of Morro, Poposa, and Gringa. And the fault is paleozoic, and the fault get reactivated between 14 and 8.5 million years ago. It was reactivated, and also with a secondary fault, that's the Colorado fault. And then we have this yellow fault here in the greens, the arch younger fault between 8.5 and 6. Basically, the results of this give us an excellent structural preparation in different places. But one that I want to mention is this one of Morro Poposa. That is one of the relatively new targets. We knew about Poposa, but we're now extended the target of Poposa and Morro here. So your multiple mineral centers, excellent ground preparation and structure. Now, this is a plan view of the whole thing. You can see the scale here. Now, this is 1.5 kilometers every block. So it's a big area here, like 7 by 6 kilometers. This is the position of Gringa, Morro, Poposa, Punta Cana, Tocota, and Colorado. This is a plan view of the magnetic data that we have. You can see how when we go deeper, this is a high elevation, 5,500. We cut 500 meters below. Is this map that you see here, this big map, magnetics anomaly. And we go to 4,000 meters, is the deeper. We can see this very consistent, well-developed magnetic anomaly in the district. Magnetic anomalies are important because they are related to the magmas that are, at the end of the day, the sources of the metals that we look for. So important to have the magma. We know it's there, and we can do a lot of work with the magnetic data, but also with the chargeability. The chargeability is we cover a smaller area, but you can see how well-developed is La Gringa in terms of the mag or the IP chargeability anomaly, Punta Cana, and the new anomaly of Colorado I want to mention to that we'll describe today, and Morro Poposa. So we have very good signature mag and chargeability, the right anomalies. This is a section between Punta Cana and Poposa, section that goes, let me get my pointer. A section that goes from Punta Cana to Tocota, is this one here, a beautiful anomaly, mag anomaly in Punta Cana and Tocota that we never drilled before. We are planning to drill that this next season. So a beautiful gray anomaly. And then this is from Punta Cana to La Gringa. So we have the macro features are the right ones. We have done this, all this work shows that. Now going target by target very quickly, this is Morro. We put some holes, you probably don't remember, but like 3 years ago, we drilled this hole, fold 2202, and we got B veins and molybdenum anomalies at the end of the hole around 400 meters. And we knew that we needed to move to the north because of the results that we got at the time. But now that we did this structural analysis, and then we have done the geophysics, we know that all this area here is probably the center of this big, more porphyry system of we call now Poposa Morro. This one, we are going to also planning to drill this season. The size is really good. You know, we are talking about 1.5 kilometer by 1 kilometer, that one. It's a good photo of Morro. This is the area where diatrin was drilled before we came here. It's a diatrin with pieces of alter rock to potassic alteration on the hills here. We found breccias with pieces of early porphyry type veinlets, and we also found dikes with type porphyry style veining. So this place is, as you can see, has a really really the good characteristics to be host of the porphyry system here. So we're going to drill that one. The other one is very good. It's all the way to the north. It's a new anomaly we call Colorado. We knew about Colorado. The Gringa is just behind Colorado here in the back. in like a 2 kilometer in that direction. There was a breccia here that we mapped 5 years ago, and we found in this breccia, it's a hydrothermal breccia with good copper and gold mineralization up to 13 gram gold and almost 4% copper in some places. And we found pieces of porphyry with A veins in this breccia. And we knew the breccia was coming down and covered by talus here. But now we did the IP along the valley, the Chita Valley, and we found this IP anomaly here. So you can see now in this image, that will be the breccia. And this is the IP anomaly. And very good shape of the IP anomaly. The scale here, this is like a 700 meters. So it's, you know, a good size, 700 meters pro for another 700 meters. And we also have in the same place a relatively lower, you can see this is resistivity, a little this V-shaped resistivity, probably associated to the porphyry or a breccia. And the good thing is come very close to the surface. It's covered by the gravels. And also the magnetic anomaly show us a magnetic high. So it has all the ingredients, has the copper gold, has the breccias, has the chargeability. And since we are in this section, I want to mention about this new IP anomaly that we found next to La Gringa. So the section here underneath, you can see that will be, this is the area of La Gringa here that we drill. This is the new anomaly. This is what we call the Molly Halo. I want to talk about that one. And we think they are not connected, Colorado and Gringa at this moment, but they could be connected and be one thing. It's, all of this is covered by the gravels of the Chita Valley. An excellent target, easy to drill, is no relatively no high elevation. We can drill very early on on this anomaly. The other one is Tocota that I mentioned, this beautiful magnetic anomaly that I showed you in the section. This is the neck of an extratovolcano that was in place 8.6 million years ago. You can see the volcanics in the back, and these are the dioritic rocks. We have porphyry style mineralization here in this area, and we have gold and baggy silica around. You can see the veinlets, porphyry style veinlet, the right geochemistry, and the magnetic anomaly. That will be the same area that I just show you by the different scale on the surface. And you can see this big magnetic anomaly underneath. We don't have IP here, but it's very attractive because all of this is a footprint of, in this case, like a 300 meters by 300 meters with a quartz veinlet in copper and gold, and we have a bigger anomaly around, like another 500 to 700 meters of bismuth, tellurium, and other anomalies. So we never drilled this because we didn't have access. But now, as you can see in this image, we have the road here. That's a Toyota right there. We have the access, and now we can drill. We can come here and drill right from the middle of the anomaly in underneath here. Tocota is a great target, never drilled before. The plan for us is to drill in this season. Punta Cana is something that we drilled a couple of years ago. We really like it. You can see the magnetic anomaly there. We came almost for no values on the surface, but with some porphyry veinlets. And then we end up with 192 meters of 0.34 gram equivalent gold. Definitely is increasing. So what we want to do here is to come and reopen this drill hole here and keep going deeper to see if we can find vertical zoning into higher grade material. So we are talking now, was Tocota, Morro, Punta Poposa, we talk about Colorado, we talk about Tocota, now about Punta Cana, you have four porphyry systems in the area. And to finish in hearing Don Julio, this is the place where we did more work. We have done more work so far in terms of drilling. It's La Gringa. If this area here is the area we put three holes and we found a zoning from advanced argillic, sericitic, and to potassic. We found a high moly, big section of high moly mineralization related to B veins, a big diatreme in here that is intramineral. It has mineralization that is fragments of rock that are mineralized and also is mineralized post-breccia. So what we think that may happen, you can see in the section here, we do a section here, is that the drill holes has the molybdenum anomaly in here. And now we think that these magnetic anomalies is the diatreme, that we think that maybe the best copper zone, it will be somewhere here in the middle. So the plan for us, if we drill, is to go back to this drill hole and continue the drill hole into the magnetic anomaly. You can same thing here. You can see the limit of advanced argillic, sericitic, biotitic, and the moly halo. So that's Don Julio. I don't want to spend more time. You saw the press release. It really has been 5 years of amazing work of all the team. A lot of investments, around $60 million US invested in this project to get to this point where we are now. And we hope that we can find a, you know, really a big porphyry, at least one big porphyry system in this property. The other one that you are aware is El Fierro, that we drilled also a couple of years ago. Last year was probably the last season. We found a large porphyry system here. There's like a 4 kilometers by 1.5 kilometers. We found sericitic alteration and porphyry style veinlets. Because access, we were able to drill only in this small area that's fenced there. We found the porphyries there. We found multiple phases of intrusive and breccias with potassic alteration, with A veins, with albitic alteration, with actinolite, with copper and gold. We believe that this area that we drilled, the small area, still has potential at depth. And also, we need to explore more the rest of the property because we may have the best grade and best porphyry in another part of here. So this property, just to know, we are working, trying to look for a partner, because to do the next exploration level, we would like to find a partner like we did with South 32 and bring it to the next stage with a mid-tier producer or a big copper producer. So we are, it's a great property. We have done all the work, it's ready to drill. Something new is to do these two properties that I mentioned. You know, this map, what you can see here is, this is Sable Don Julio property here, and this is Min South. So this is where we are working, where Min South is drilling with South 32 in this moment, very active with a discovery they had last year. You can see, you remember that they have a drill hole there in the valley, 786 meters with around 0.8% copper equivalent. Excellent drill hole. And there is a trend that is northwest in here, but this is, you know, go from low to high in the Andes. This is the limit of the eastern limit of the Andes. Then when you go in that direction, we go to the east. This is flat, a lower elevation, relatively speaking, around 2,900 meters. And it's covered by gravels a lot. So a lot of these magnetic anomalies are covered mostly by gravels. So there's not much outcrop. But there seems to be another trend that is northwest that include the Hualilan gold project that has reported 2.8 million ounces of gold. So I want to show you, we put a press release not too long ago by the PDAC about Cerro Negro. We haven't mentioned Potrerio before, that is this anomaly here. But I'll show you what we are doing because this is covered by gravels. Here's the magnetic anomaly, and this is mostly covered by gravel with few outcrops. So we came here and we mapped and we found a small window of cropping on the magnetic anomaly. And there is an intrusive rock there that is Miocene, around 8 million years old. So that's good news because we're finding that's the metallogenetic age of the magma that we are chasing for porphyry system. And also we found values up to 0.1% copper and 64% moly that are very good in propylitic alteration. And everything is covered by gravels. So since we cannot do much in gravel, what we did is IP. And IP came, is the magnetic anomaly, is low chargeability. And around, like a ring, we have this strong chargeability anomaly. This one is opening. We need to extend the lines probably in that direction now. And also a big resistivity around. So that's a good combination, this central mag, high chargeability, high resistivity around. And the moly. So what we did is we took samples on the gravels here and used a different geochemical technique. It's called MMI. And it's used in porphyry systems in Chile. Has been a lot of success in Chile exploring places like this. And we got excellent geochemical results on these ones in the lines that we put in here. So it's looking very good. This is a good access. You can see the paper road. It goes through here. So we can do all our gear around. It's cheaper to work in here. And the same thing with the project is to the north, that's Potrerios. And this is a good example of what Sable does. with generating new ideas and be the first one looking for something in new areas. And they were, I think that's it. It's that's the update of what we have been doing in San Juan.
All right. Well, thank you for the update. So we have a couple of questions. The first one is just about Don Julio. And can you give us a bit of a rundown of which targets have been drilled in the past and which ones might be planned for drilling?
Yeah, in the past, we drilled Punta Cana. We put three holes. We drilled in the Valley of the Gringa. We put a few holes there in the Diatrine in the valley. It's the most drill hole. I don't remember the number, but probably nine holes there, seven holes. And we put three holes in Poposa that we consider not now that one of the in on the limit of the Morro Poposa target. So the Morro Poposa has been partially drilled. So those have been some holes. Tocota never been drilled, so we're going to drill this time. In Colorado, we never drilled before, so we're trying to drill this season. And remember, also, we drilled something that we drilled and killed. It was the skarn, the Fermín skarn, that was we tested it. We don't believe that it's a high priority target there anymore.
Got it. And Colorado, sorry, I'm butchering these names. How does the estimated size and depth compare to the other targets?
The size, the so far what we see, because we limited the data with the IP, but it's like at least 500 meters by 500 meters, let's say at least. It can be 1 by 1 kilometer, but, and which compare with a good porphyry size, you know, for 500 by 500 is a good porphyry size. We compare with Tocota or Punta Cana and other porphyries in the world. And the depth, if the IP anomaly that looked just below the gravels is related to mineralization, well, it could be something shallow, very shallow.
Okay. Yeah. Got it. And then, so you said Poposa has been expanded to include this new zone, Morro. Is this, yeah. So if, what kind of led you to expand the target? And is it one bigger target or is it two?
No, we think that was a bigger, it's just one big target. With the hole that we drilled in Poposa, we drilled once, and the last one that we drilled end out 400 meters in a good moly anomaly with B veins, and we lost the hole. By the way, that's the reason we didn't, for technical reasons, that we didn't continue the hole, and so we continued the work to the north because it has these indications, and we found now brechas with fragments of porphyries. We found dikes with veinlets in the on surface. And we also found this structural preparation that I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation that is one of the areas from the structural point of view, probably with the best structural preparation in the property and associated nice magnetic and chargeability anomalies. The whole thing came together and we can see the limit of that now. It's just one big target.
Okay, got it. Thank you. And then, Tocota, how much do the latest soil sampling results expand that target?
You know, at the beginning, by the way, this is a view. Tocota just behind the hill there in this photo. It's behind the hill there. And the original outcropping, sub-outcropping area with veinlets was very small, a few meters apart. And then when we found boulders, it was more 200 meters by 250. And now probably we are talking again 500 meters by 500 meters of this very consistent anomaly of with a copper gold. And toward this area, exactly where these guys are walking, the area back there, is a very great, very nice anomaly of bismuth, tellurium, the arsenic, so more look like a more higher level in the system. But the core of the system so far, I would say it will be like a 500 by 500 meter holes.
Wow, pretty big.
Yeah.
And then do you have a sense of like moving on to the 24-25 field season at Don Julio? Do you have a sense of when drilling would start?
Yeah, we normally start in, we started organizing the camp in September because of weather and drilling in October, especially now that we have the Colorado target that is easier, better access. we will have no problem to start drilling in October.
And do you have a sense of the size of the program? Would it be similar to like the past?
Well, similar than what we are looking for. We remember that this, at the end of the day, we need to have the approval of South 32 because they pay this. But what we would like to have is 5,500 meters. So we will see. We are in conversation right now. We're in the process of reviewing the data, defining where the drill hole, where are the targets, how many holes we should drill. And then later we need to decide, okay, how many meters will they authorize and where and how we distribute the meters in the different targets.
Okay, got it. And you touched on the agreement. So can you remind us of the terms of the earn-in agreement with South 32?
Yes, they have to invest up to, including the payment of the, I think it's like $8.5 million in the ground U.S., plus the payment of the underlying agreement. It's another $4 million for something. So they need to spend around $12 to $13 million to get the option to get to 65%. Although I think they spend more than that now. Don't remember the exact number, but I spend more than, I think they probably are around $10 million now. But then what they get is the option. Anytime from now on, they can say, okay, I'm going to go to 65%. And at that point, if they decide to go to a PEA study in one of these targets, they can, if they finish the PEA, they can get to 75%.
Got it. Thank you. And then moving on to some of your other projects. So Cerro Negro is kind of the focus for the near term going to be like geophysics, or would you look to start drilling there?
We need to do there because we saw that it's working very well, the MMI, the geochemistry, and it's all you can do in these gravels. And there are good examples like Spence and some places in Argentina and Chile that have been tested these things, this geochemistry and IP. So IP and MMI geochemistry will be the next steps. We need to extend the lines that we have at IP. And we need to extend the lines of with the geochemistry. And also we need to do the same thing in Potrerillo, the other anomaly to the north. The good thing with those ones are, like I said, old. We don't need to put big camps. It's relatively more, not that too expensive, no, to work in this part of Don Julio. Although you can see this is a really nice photo, by the way, the Magda. This is the limit, the eastern limit of the Andes. Looking to the east. And those are the areas where Cerro Negro and those places are in the back. And those places are covered by gravels in the park. So the elevation here is 5,500 meters where we are here, taking the photo. And the elevation down there in the valley is like a 2,800, 2,600. So here the mountains are outcropping. Down there is covered by the gravels. But the difference is here, we need to put a camp. It's more expensive. Down there, we can just drive to the nearest town. And yeah, we want to put some emphasis now to do a follow-up, and we are pioneers in doing that work because everybody stopped their exploration right here because this cover of gravels in the back.
Got it. Thank you. And then turning to El Fierro, you said Piros. I'm butchering his name.
Piros.
So that's the number one target. So are you looking to kind of define that or find more targets?
No. The work is complete there. We've done all the geophysics, all the everything. We just need to drill more. And okay. So we're ready to drill, and we are in conversation with companies about the possibility to do a partnership and continue the drilling. If that happens, we may be drilling at the end of this year.
Got it. Thank you. And last question from me, is there any other work ongoing at any of the other projects?
No, in this moment, like I said, we dropped the poncha. And so we are focused in these 70,000 hectares that we have in Don Julio. We have another 39 or 40,000 hectares in Fierro. So big land packages. We have another 4,000, probably around 3,000, 4,000 in Cerro Negro, and another 14,000 in Potrerillo. So that's where most of the focus on the work that we do is in there, no? And that, yeah.
Thanks, Magda. Those are the hard questions. I always ask the easier ones, Ruben. So a couple audience ones here. So how likely is it you'll find partners for your programs?
I think it's very likely. They're very good projects. And San Juan is a very good jurisdiction. So the combination of good projects, nice work that we have done in a great jurisdiction, I think that is very likely that we will get a partner.
Okay. And then another audience question, just asking about profit projection for the next 12 months. Maybe worth reminding people that you're in the exploration stage. So
yeah,
currently not generating any cash flow. And then some of my questions. So can you remind us of your cash balance currently?
I think that at the beginning I put it's 8.4 million Canadian in the cash in this moment.
Okay. And are you looking to acquire additional projects right now or just sticking with
what? Yeah, we have been very active, not for the last month, but for the last 14 months now. We have been looking at a lot of projects in different places of the Americas, only focus on the Americas, all the way from British Columbia to Argentina, Chile, Mexico, Peru. We have been looking around, but trying to find an opportunity that can create real value for us. No? And yes, working hard on that.
And what sort of parameters are you looking for? What types of projects are you looking at?
Well, we looked at our objective always being done to find especially big porphyry systems. You know, that's what, you know, porphyry copper gold system will be always our preference. You know, everybody knows the need of the world of copper. You know, everybody agrees that we don't have to go to a big discussion on that. The world will need to find big porphyry systems. The porphyries are the largest copper producers of the world. So if we find a good porphyry system, we are in good business, and we always have in those deposits byproduct like silver, copper, gold, and moly. So that's the main objective. And also, we have no problem if we find a good gold project, you know, that it can be a good size and profitable.
And you looking at grassroots or more advanced? What's your sweet spot?
Mostly, you know, like you said, we are greenfield exploration at best. We like to start to go to these places with large footprints where people probably miss something and we can find a big deposit. I prefer in this moment, if it's something a little bit more advanced, the somebody already did some work and then we can step on continue the work on the place like that. I would prefer something more advanced, but if we can find something else like a Don Julio again, all over again, I will have no problem with taking it. But it's very difficult to find those properties now available. So I will go first for the footprint for the type of deposit. Later, if I have to pick, I will pick something more advanced.
And you referenced a potential sale of the BC royalty portfolio. Can you provide an update on that process?
I haven't moved too much into that. We prepare all the information. We have all the data ready to move on in the moment that we decide to put it for sale. And probably now that we are getting to, we got $11.4 million. Remember we can go, you know, for a while, a little long, but for the work that we do with that money. So, but definitely I would say that this year is the year that we should put those for sale and start moving those things, looking around, have some offers and have a real idea how much we can get out of those things.
Okay, that's all the questions I have. I don't see any other audience questions. Is there anything you wanted to talk about today that we didn't cover, Ruben?
Not really. The thing is, yeah, I'll probably say that it's nice to go back, come back and give a good update. We are going to update a website now that with all the information. So we were just working hard for many months in these projects. Hopefully we can, you know, after on these all these things that we are looking around for new options, if we can get something new that can add value to the projects. So we will keep informing and we'll keep updating the website to get all the information to the shareholders.
Sounds good. Well, it looks like your market timing's right to come back and start telling the story again. Feels like we're in a bit of a better market for juniors.
I see the volume lately has been really great. You see the volume has been like a $2 million per day. I don't know, it's a million shares per day.
Yeah, that's good.
High bulk. Yeah, maybe it's just the gold going high.
Yeah, well, it's starting to trickle down, right? Yeah. Smaller companies are starting to catch a bid. So, looks like exciting times. Thanks for the update, Ruben. If anyone has any questions or would like a one-on-one, feel free to reach out. We can arrange that for you. And yeah, looking forward to hearing more out of Sable. Thanks,
Ruben. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.